A great scientist who works with various organizations in India. My friend, philosopher, guide, and what have you. He's like my brother, Dr. Karthikeyan, and my other brothers and sisters present here, and my good friend, whom I call Tony, but he's Anurup Singh, and the members of the Life Positive. I like that word, life positive. Yeah? Life has to be positive. There should be no negativity in life. Life Positive Movement, let me call it as. Journal, of course. Members of the press, ladies and gentlemen. Well, I must thank Dr. Karthikeyan for making this contact between the Life Positives, Agarwal Saab, and Ahluwalia Saab. Ahluwalia Saab and Suma Vargis and the Life Positive Movement, and inviting me here for this keynote address, which I love because this is my passion in life. Like in any other walk of life, we should not have caste system in healing. There shouldn't be different castes of people. Western medicine, alternate medicine, complementary medicine. This is a copy of the American style, CAM. CAM is an American word. Which but what I like about Americans is they teach CAM in the conventional medical college. Their course is 4 years because it's after graduation, which they call as MD. But 3.5 years they teach the Western medicine. I don't want to call it as modern medicine. Western medicine. And 6 months they teach what's called CAM. Very interestingly, Ayurveda is excluded in CAM. So I was fighting with the American establishment. But the reason is not America, reason is our government. You can practice acupuncture in New York, legally. You can't practice Ayurveda in New York. Because China did not forget their past when they became independent in 1948. We of course had British leaders in India after independence. You probably don't know these incidents. When they wanted to have a CNC, Commander-in-Chief, our then Prime Minister called all the generals in the army and said, look, we don't have a really experienced man to be a CNC. So why not we have a British man invited here to be a first CNC. There was this General Rathod who had the courage to talk to the Prime Minister, and he got up and said, Mr. Prime Minister, since we do not have an experienced man to be the Prime Minister, why don't we invite a Britisher to be the Prime Minister of India? And our friend was completely stunned. He never expected that answer. So he said, would you like to be the CNC? He said, no. We have a CNC, potential CNC, who is better than any British CNC or general, and that is General Karyapa. That is how General Karyapa became the CNC first time. So unfortunately what happens is, we have been having Western ideas, I call them RNIs, resident non-Indians. They live here, but their mind and the intellect is from the West. So they continued the Western thoughts, and never ever allowed Ayurveda and other systems to grow under the tutelage of the government. So it grew on its own, that's a different thing, because it can grow. Even if you try to kill Ayurveda, it won't die, because Ayurveda is the mother of all medical wisdoms in this universe, if you really go deep into history. Alexander the Great invaded India, but of course he didn't come to India, but his army came up to North India, couldn't go down further because malaria killed most of the soldiers. But while they went back, they took all the pandits and the texts from India. And they went back to Alexandria. Alexander did not go back. He found a beautiful girl in Persia and called himself the Emperor of Persia and died of typhoid fever. And the treatment in Western medicine for typhoid fever was bloodletting. When he died, he wrote a beautiful thing. He said, his dead body must be carried by doctors, to show to the world that these so-called doctors, Western medical doctors, have not been able to save the great emperor. Number two, His hands must be outside the coffin to say that the emperor did not take anything with him. 3, all the germs and other things must be strewn all over the road on the path to the cemetery, because people should know that wealth collecting does not really help. You collect all the money, and if you want to be happy, give it. Beautiful thoughts. Anyway, the textbooks went to Alexandria, and Alexander had built a beautiful, what do you call, academia, a beautiful hall for people to come there and exchange ideas and brainstorm. What a thoughtful thing in those days. And Alexandria lived on even after Alexander died. And Alexandria, the Greeks had two kinds of meetings. One is called seminar, the other one is called symposia. Seminar is derived from semen. So if you have a seminar, you must have a new idea at the end of that, because semen produces a new baby, so a new idea. Symposium is a nice word for Greeks. You come there, talk, discuss, agree to disagree, eat, drink, and go. So most of our meetings are the second half. The first half doesn't come. So the scholars there studied Ayurveda, and if you look at Hippocrates' treatise, it is nothing but a translated version of Charaka Samhita. The pulse examination, the Tridosha theory, the humors theory, and if you go deep into it, almost everything is copied. What do you call modern medicine now? See, we have an idea, anything modern must come from America or the West. Otherwise, it's not modern. That is not the meaning of the word modernity. Modernity should come from our antiquity. We improve our antiquity and become modern. That's the idea. I'll give you one example in this context before I forget. Lot of work has been done on Ayurvedic drugs, homeopathic drugs, based on the Western model of reductionism. Now, for example, you want to study something in Ayurveda. Even the government of India was at that time sponsoring what's called a golden triangle method. That is, you know this drug helps this disease, so you don't have to search for it. You take the Ayurvedic drug, find out what chemical it has got. That's what these chemists mostly think. The chemical is the most important thing. And take the chemical out and then study it. I had written to the then Director General, whose baby it was, that this won't work, because it is not the bits that make the whole. Remember that. If you now understand quantum physics, it's the interconnectedness that makes the whole. When you don't have the interconnectedness, nothing works. For example, garlic. Come, madam. Morning. Yeah. Yes. The bits do not have the properties of the whole. Give an example. There are 42 studies on garlic pearls. At the end of which, the British Medical Journal editor wrote an editorial. Garlic is good for cooking, but not for as a medicine. So I wrote to her, Fiona, you have not done any studies on garlic. What you have done studies is garlic pearls. Good boy. What you have done is, sulfhydryl group. So you take the SH group and make the garlic into a pearl. So it's good for the germs for their health in the toilet. It will go directly out as nothing. I wrote to her, if you want to do studies on garlic, you must have garlic, take it in the mouth, munch it for a half a minute, 2 minutes. Then it becomes the alanine in garlic, gets mixed with the trypsin in the saliva and becomes allicine. And allicine is a medicine. So some young scientists in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research caught up with this paper, and they did something phenomenal. Brahmi, you know Brahmi Ek Patta? So they said, lot of work has been done on Brahmi's extracts, nothing happened. These boys made a chutney out of Brahmi, which my grandmother used to do before I went for the exam, and she used to give it was good for memory, she used to say. When I went to the medical school and got my degree and all, I thought, my grandmother is a bloody fool. What does she know about it? That's what we think, the Western thoughts. Anyway, these boys did that and fed a group of rats. Within 6 months, the rats became so brilliant, they could get out of any maze. They killed the rat, and what they found was the hippocampus major, the area of the brain which is for memory. Mind you, the mind is not in the brain, but the memory is in the brain, and that has become 3 times its normal size. And when they cut open the hippocampus major, they found the cells were hyperactive. So this paper you must read. It's in, it's so beautiful a paper done by this. And they got a crore of grant also from the granting agency. Usually the grants are not coming for this kind of studies. So it is not the bits and pieces that make the thing. It's the whole that makes the thing. That's the essence of Ayurveda and the essence of everything. Western medicine only follows reductionism. You take a chemical, a part of it, and do what is called RCT, randomized controlled trials, and which we think is the basis of all our scientific medicine, quote unquote, scientific medicine. What is the science of it? I will come to that later. So this is the difference. So modernity should come from our antiquity. There's an old saying in Latin, respice to prospice. If you want to look forwards, you will look backwards. Even throwing a javelin throw, you don't throw like this. It won't go far. Take it back and throw it, it'll go very far. So go back to our ancient wisdom. Everything that is in the modern science now, I'm not talking the conventional dead Western science of physics, chemistry and biology. The modern evolutionary science, evolutionary biology, systems biology, which comes to Ayurveda. Quantum physics has almost come to Advaita. And quantum physics has now revolutionized scientific look at what we do. Come back, as so beautifully put by Max Planck, there is no perception without a perceiver. Let us say, I do an work on a rat or a dog and say it is science. If you do on the same rat work, the results will be 40% difference. If a woman does work on the rat and a man does work on the same rat, difference can be 20 to 60%. If you change your pheromone, you just put on a nice scent, whole body you bathe with a very expensive scent and go and do the work, it will be different. The rat has a perception. You have a perception. You have a consciousness, rat has a consciousness. And they interact and the results are totally different. This is very interesting. This shows that all our Western scientific reductionist studies are not true, which is being proved one by one. Like, for example, Karthikeyan was talking about cholesterol. I said, cholesterol cannot be a disease for the simple reason that if you try to lower your cholesterol, the body will produce more cholesterol. If you try to stop the cholesterol being made, because 90% of the cholesterol is made in your liver, because for your good, let us say, you live a very high-fly life on the edge of it. You know, you are running after money, you're running after power, you're running after chair. I always tell people, Indians are Peter Jnanis. They may not be Jnana Peters, but they are Peter Jnanis. They know how to sit in the chair and how to get someone out of the chair and occupy the chair. Now come to that level of what is happening now is we run a life which is full of stress. I want to destroy somebody. I want to take him off that chair and sit there. All this will make you very, very tense. And to save you at that time, to produce more steroids to keep you going, you require more cholesterol. If you don't have cholesterol, you can't make steroid hormones. So body makes more cholesterol for your own good. Otherwise, what you eat, whether you eat grass or you eat beef every 3 times a day, it doesn't matter because 10% of the cholesterol comes from the food. Actually, 1960, late 60s, we had a BBC big debate on cholesterol. There was one lady, she had a big diary. She gave a challenge to everybody on the television. She said, whatever is your cholesterol level, come to me. I'll give you milk in the morning, milk in the afternoon, milk at night, and get your cholesterol down. At that time, I thought she was foolish. But now I know she is right, because if you feed more cholesterol from outside, your body will produce less cholesterol. See, that's what's called the body's intelligence. Now, anyway, I'm very happy that recently, not recently, 3 years ago, the American government, the USDA, which once in five years it gives its pronouncement, saying that cholesterol is not a disease, so you must eat better and you must eat more. And they said eggs, bacon and ham are probably the ideal breakfast rather than eating all that junk that you have today. Now this U-turn came after millions of people have suffered from cholesterol-lowering drugs. So let us not in the first place ape everything that is the Western one and think it is modern, and then you call it as a modern science. Now, how did science become science? Medicine become a science? You know the story? Well, in Europe, Modern, so-called modern medicine today started 5,000 years ago as mumbo-jumbo, witchcraft and sorcery on the Nile Valley. It moved from there, went to Arabia. And one man who changed the course of so-called modern medicine today was Ibn Sina, who the American scholars Avicenna. Avicenna is not his name, he is Ibn Sina. And Ibn Sina had added a lot of sense into the so-called witchcraft of the modern medicine. Then it went to Greece. Greece, of course, it had the influence of Hippocrates and others in Greece. And from then it moved on. And in Europe, 12th century, all churches, most churches became universities overnight. That's why today the gown that you wear for the convocation, the vice chancellor, chancellor, deacon, rector, these are all church terminologies and they have nothing to do with education. They are ecumenical terminologies. So these universities accepted medicine as science. So one fine morning, you become science. You understand that? That's the definition. But surgery was not accepted as science. Up until 1572, when the Royal College of Surgeons of England started, they were called barber surgeons. Even today in the West, when you pass your FRCS, you're not called a doctor, you're called Mr. Or if you're a girl, you're called Miss. And that continues even to this day because British are a great tradition and they believe in their tradition. So you are a barber surgeon. So surgery was not science at all. How did medicine become a science in America? Of course, these Europeans moved on to the New World when the New World was discovered, thanks to India, because Columbus went in search of Indian spices and lost his way and went somewhere and then got that beautiful land for them. So they should be eternally grateful to us for getting that beautiful land, large land, four times the mass of India and one-third the population of India. So they're really enjoying life at our cost. Because he said, yeah, that's why the Indians, Amerindians are called Indians. Because he said, they're Indians. He was in Cuba. But he thought he was in probably Calicut. That's the mistake he did. Now coming back to the modern medical evolution after that. America, there were 247 medical colleges around the turn of the last century. They were teaching everything. Except Ayurveda, they were teaching everything. The so-called Western medicine, so-called, homeopathy, radioesthesia, chiropractic, osteopathy, and what have you. Now, there are three brilliant men who were very rich in America at that time. Nelson's Rockefeller Sr., J.B. Morgan, and Andrew Carnegie. These were rich people. And when you're very rich, I have studied some of these rich people. When you're very rich, you want more power. You go after power. So they had a meeting together one day and said, look, each one of us fighting one another because we want to make more money, we will be rich, but we will not be powerful. So let's have a consortium, three of us join together and we can control the world. So they joined together into a consortium and got a friend of theirs to advise them as to how to control the world. Of course, initially the advice given was, you fund the First World War, you will control the world. They did that. And when they found out after some time, 15 million white men were dead in the war. If Indians and Africans were dead, nobody would have bothered. So much so in England, no girl had a husband. That's why they were given to spinning. That's why it's called spinster. Because you don't have a husband, you start spinning. So they said 15,000 white men died and so many orphans without fathers and so many girls without husbands. So war is not the best thing to fund. Then they again called this friend, gave him some more money and said, get us a better way of doing. The man said, control education and you will control the world. That was a beautiful idea. And so they said, let's control medical education first. They were already funding 47 medical colleges in America at that time, the three of them together. And they were trying to get control over these, having the board members from their companies on the board. And they influenced the American president at that time because, American presidents were elected by these rich people only. Even today, American presidents are probably elected by the drug companies. In the olden days, oil companies. Today, drug companies are three times more powerful than the oil companies. Their lobby is three times more. So they told the president, you get these medical colleges examined to see which of them are scientific and which are not. So the president said, okay, go ahead. Then they said, whom to now have this commission to... Thank you. They chose a man called Abraham Flexner, the very famous Flexner report 2010, you must have all read. Abraham Flexner was a retired headmaster of Andrew Carnegie High School. What did he know about medicine? What did he know about science? What did he know about anything? Nothing. So the Flexner goes around 247 medical colleges in 1 year, comes out with a beautiful report which said, these 47 medical colleges which are doing chemical drug trials, because they all are from NAFTA, chemical derived now, they are scientific, rest of them are not scientific. So overnight this new system classification started. What did the government do? They didn't do anything. They had no reject reaction. They published this Flexner report every day in the morning, front page of New York Times, for 1 year. Naturally, the other colleges died a natural death. No student went to them. So from this 47, it became about 99 or so now. And all these are only chemical drug treating medical colleges. That is why Western medicine is chemical drug treating science. What is science truly? Marie Curie said, science is measurement, measurement is science. If that were so, you can't think. Can you think? Can you measure your thinking? No, no. So unscientific. Thinking is unscientific. You love your boyfriend or a girlfriend. Do you? Can you measure love? Unscientific. So what cannot be measured is unscientific. So science dies a natural death when measurement. This world cannot be measured by science. That's why we only know 5% of the world. Nuclear energy, gravitational energy, and electromagnetic energy, because they can be measured. 95% of the occult energy cannot be measured, but that's the most powerful energy. I'll very soon tell you what you can do with occult energy. We'll come back to that. So, it became a science overnight, and by the wrong route, and this science has no meaning. So, they refined the diagnosis science. They came changed. John von Neumann, a Hungarian chemist, Hungarian-born ethnic chemist, American Nobel laureate, who said, I quote, science is making models. Mark my words. Science is making models, comma, which are mathematical constructs, semicolon, which with verbal jargon are supposed to work, full stop. Okay, keep the definition. Now, modern medicine, so-called scientific medicine, we say, has a scientific base of linear mathematics. Or reductionist science, which is not a holistic science. Now, human body is not linear at all. It's a dynamic, holistic system. Now, if you measure the human body linearly, what will happen? I'll give you an example. When you go to a cardiologist, he will check you and say, oh, your ejection fraction is only 40%. So, you're worried. That fear kills you. Mind you will soon die. But what is he right? What is he doing? He is using a linear mathematical model. Science is making models, right? Mathematical model. What's the really mathematical model? What is the amount of blood pumped out with each contraction of the heart? Okay? That's called ejection fraction. So he is using this linear measurement into a non-linear structure, heart. Linear mathematics is Euclidean. So Euclidean mathematics works on Euclidean structures only. It must be either a square globe, triangle, square, or oblong. Heart is neither of these, none of these. Heart cannot be. Heart actually is a non-linear structure which requires a different mathematical model which we can't understand. That's called non-linear mathematics, which in the West is called Mandelbrot's mathematics and in the East is called Vedic mathematics. Very difficult, very, very difficult. Mandelbrot alone understood it. And that's how Mandelbrot constructed the computers on the basis of binary numbers. So, non-linear mathematics is used in, linear mathematics is used in a non-linear structure. So, the ejection fraction is absolutely wrong. Sometimes we get patients with an ejection fraction of 25. He has gone to Ayyappa temple 3 times. You know where it is? It's almost like the Himalayas. I simply believe in what the patient says. I ask him, can you go up to the first floor without any trouble? Yes. Second floor, trouble. Third floor, yes. Then your ejection fraction is probably more than normal. Here is a patient with an ejection fraction of 40% from the doctor. He can't go to the toilet without having chest pain and breathlessness. That is because we are marrying linear mathematics to a non-linear structure. This is not only an intercaste marriage, it's now a marriage which has to be divorced very soon. The sooner we do, the better. So, ladies and gentlemen, I have told you, if not enough, enough to say that the Western scientific base of medicine is all wrong. Now, I've been saying this for a long time. I'm very happy last year, the chairman of the NICE, NICE is the biggest organization in England, that is the NICE is the organization which controls clinical excellence, National Institute of Clinical Excellence. Rollins, Michael Rollins, Sir Michael Rollins is the president. And Sir Rollins was giving a talk at the Royal College, what's called the appointed lectures, the named lectures. And he said, I quote, "Unfortunately, we have been giving RCTs and keeping them at a high pedestal, saying that they're a scientific thing, is not deserved. RCTs do not deserve to be the pedestal at which they are kept, which means all our studies, which you and I believe in practice also, are not true." Is it clear now? Which means the Western scientific medicine is not really scientific, if you want to know. But based on this, the class system started. Western medicine is scientific. All other things, not scientific. One day I was giving a lecture in IIT Bombay. And they had invited me to give a lecture on blood pressure. IIT, you know, IIT is all supposed to be very brilliant boys and girls and brilliant professors. So lecture went on. So I told them, what is blood pressure? A physics teacher in the class, PUC class, tells the student, laminar flow cannot exert lateral pressure because if it does, then it can't flow cosine 90, 0. Right? Yeah. Mucks up. Passes CET with very high rank. Gets into the medical school. Physiology professor comes, class. Lateral pressure exerted by the flowing blood is called lateral blood pressure. That's blood pressure. Lateral pressure exerted by the flowing blood on the vessel wall is called blood pressure. I said, what is this? Where do these two things go? Second thing is, does the blood flow laminarly inside the blood vessel? Suppose you give an obstruction of the blood pressure, we say, oh, it's very bad obstruction. Have you heard of the Bernoulli effect? As a matter of fact, the blood flow may be better with a little obstruction. I was telling Karthikeyan Saab that the obstruction to the coronary arteries. See, with the simple three things we didn't ask ourselves. Why don't animals get a heart attack? Why only man should get a heart attack? Have you ever thought about it? Number two, coronary arteries fill in diastole, not in systole. So the pressure head is so low that why should coronary arteries have atherosclerosis? I can understand the carotid arteries, leg arteries having, because the pressure is high, systemic pressure. Here, diastolic pressure. So if you ask these three questions, it will be very clear to you that atherosclerosis is not a disease at all. Atherosclerosis is a good thing that the body does to band-aid an injury to your vessel wall. It's a beautiful band-aid. Actually, Valentin Fuster, a very famous cardiologist, interventional cardiologist in Washington, has written, I quote, he said, less than 30% of the infarct-related coronary arteries are more than 50% blocked. Did you understand that? Less than 30% of the infarct-related vessel means the vessel which supplies the heart attack area, which is a block, are less than 50% blocked. So bigger block is not important, lesser block is important. And if you go deep into it, you find out animals do not get a heart attack because animals can produce vitamin C in their system. You and I get a heart attack because we don't have capacity to produce vitamin C. So heart attack possibly is a younger brother of scurvy. You heard scurvy, you bleed everywhere. Here you bleed into the vessel wall and then the vessel wall gets blocked and then heart attack comes. I mean, we don't think. Every newborn child, wrote Alexis Carrel, a Nobel laureate surgeon who taught surgeons how to stitch blood vessels. He wrote, every newborn child is a genius, only to be converted into an idiot in school. Because he stopped thinking. Otherwise, a student who is supposed to be a good student, quote unquote, who gets highest mark is called a good student, no? He's the best mugger. Who has said cosine 90 is zero, how can he accept the physiology professor saying that cosine 90 is the cause? Then one professor of physics got up during question hour. He said, you're a brilliant lecture. I too don't believe in this blood pressure and all. I don't take medicines for that. But you mentioned Ayurveda. That's scientific. Then you are a quack. I don't want to listen to you. This is the attitude of a professor in the IIT of physics. So I told him, sir, I'm so sorry. You are a professor in IIT. He didn't like that. He was very angry. I told him, I thought professors in IIT are wise people. You are a knowledgeable man in your subject, but you have no wisdom. Because you don't know what Ayurveda is. And you are talking about a thing you don't know. And Ayurveda probably has got the strongest scientific base because it depends on non-linear mathematics. Ayurveda depends on non-linear mathematics. And Ayurveda probably has the best base of... And Ayurveda has a beautiful idea. It's not the idea of... Ayurveda's idea is life positive. Swastasya, swastha, rakshitam. Preserve the health of the well. From the community point of view, very economical model. On a given day, about 2% of the people will be sick. 98% are well. If you can try and preserve their wellness without getting them to go into sickness, won't you save millions and millions and trillions of dollars? Now, you all want cancer to go away from this world, no? Is that right? Anybody wants cancer to be here more? More? No? Lot of people want cancer to be here more. Government has permitted 240 chemicals to be used in various human things, including eating things, which are all carcinogenic. I'll give you an example. Many of you don't have lipstick. You know the lipstick you put? It's got so many pro-estrogens that a study recently showed that the Western breast size has increased one size more. 30 size has become 31 in the last 25 years because the pro-estrogens in lipstick. I wrote to the airlines here. I wrote to, what's his name? Goyal. Because he insists that the air hostess put not lipstick once, but before each flight they must put the lipstick. Otherwise they are punished for that. And the supervisors see and say, your lipstick is not up to the mark. So I wrote to him, don't kill your girls. After all, why lipstick? Probably people don't know the history of lipstick. Did you know that? How many of you know the history of lipstick? Nobody? Shall I tell you? Secret. The prostitutes in Paris, they were not selling their wares by, you know, exposing themselves. They were putting the color of their vagina onto the lips so to sell that idea to the prospective customers. That's how lipstick started. Different colors. Jodi, I should not have said that. Anyway, unparliamentary. But that's exactly what it was. And we promote that today. A newborn baby in America today has 242 chemicals in the umbilical cord, which means it has come from the mother. Now, are you really thinking of curtailing cancer? I don't think so. There are 4,000 articles which are not published, hidden, not published under the carpet, which say eating meat regularly makes the body system acidic, and that's one of the very important causes of cancer. Did you know that? You knew that? I see, I didn't know this. Government permits that. Government helps you that. You know the scent you put, pitch and all. It has got so many chemicals, carcinogens. You put sunscreen, there's an advertisement, don't go in the sun, you'll get skin cancer. If skin cancer were due to sun's rays, every dog, every buffalo, every cow should have had skin cancer and become extinct. Because you expose only some parts of your body. The whole back of these quadrupeds expose the sun all the time he is out. It's a great thing. We saw that Swamiji now has changed little. Kartikeyan's house, he was doing a scientific study on a Swamiji. He will not eat anything. And Kalamma, Kartikeyan's great wife, was alive those days and she was keeping a careful watch on him. He'll not take any food. Stand there for 4 hours and look at the sun. Without batting an eyelid. And his eyes were examined in Moorfield Eye Hospital in London, the oldest and the best eye hospital. They said his eyes are the beautiful eyes. Today we know, there's a nice study if you want to know. Nobody is putting dark glasses inside. Using the dark glasses is one of the ways you are preventing the ultraviolet rays from the sun entering your retina and making your eyes good. And you will be surprised. The ultraviolet rays of the sun going through the retina stimulate your pineal gland, which is the master of the whole orchestra of endocrines. So half of your problem is because you put on a... Some of our politicians put it on at night also. Because they can't look you in the eye. You know, it's so nice to look at the sun. So nice to be in the sun. I take an opportunity in the airport and all, and you know, the queue is there for getting into the plane in some southern, it's very hot sun. I will be the last in the queue because I want to get more of the sun at least, because, you know, otherwise we are all the time inside the house. We don't go out. I tell women, just sit in the sun for 1 hour in the morning, 1 hour in the evening. Go for a walk. You don't have to take anything for your bones. Your bones will be fine. And this people don't do because ladies are afraid. Sunscreen is the cause of skin cancer. Government permits the sunscreen. So we don't want diseases to go, because if disease go away, what will we do? Truly true. So, now coming back to this caste system, in the life positive movement, let us end this caste system. Let us get everybody who says he is a healer together into one, on one table. And it can't be done independently, because if you talk to a allopath, or what you call allopath, all everything is allopathy, remember that, except homeopathy, all things are allopathy. Ayurveda is also allopathy. Now if you ask a Western doctor to suggest an Ayurvedic fellow for a treatment, he won't do that. And you can't ask them to come together. What we do in our research center in Chennai is, when we find we can't do anything for a particular person, we know some Ayurvedic people and homeopaths who are very good, and we call them and say, look, take charge of this patient. And what we do is we record all the things and send the patient there and record the outcomes also. So we're building a big database. And we have a few people. There's one lady in I won't tell the name because it'll be advertising her. She can do very well for renal failures. See, America, I want to send her to America, because in America there's a rule now, though we say Western medicine is very good now. If you are 65, you are not given a kidney transplant, even if your kidney is failing. For the rest of your life, you will be on dialysis. And dialysis is such a nasty thing if you want to be on. If you are 65, no transplant. This is the medicine that we practice. What we should do, and Ahluwalia Ji should strive to do this, because, you know, for all these things, you need money, man. Without money, nothing happens. Money is the thing that runs this world. And I always say, money is the cause of all diseases. Did you know that? No, you didn't. I'll tell you this study. There's a nice study which shows that. If you have a money, you must push this idea. We must get these people together and have a database which says who is good for treating what. A lot of people claim, oh, I do this, that and all. I'll tell you a recent example. We had a nurse whom Karthikeyan knows, Rama. She runs our whole research center. This girl had an upper respiratory infection, I tell you. Fever, etc., etc. She took all the antibiotics and all. She was in bed with such bad sinusitis, this and that. We have a homeopath who is very good in this area. So we sent her to that homeopath. 3 days later, she is back at work. Absolutely fine. I called her yesterday and said, Rama, how are you? She said, I am fine, sir. Fit as a fiddle. 10 days she suffered taking antibiotics. Each antibiotic pill you take kills millions of germs in your gut. And when the gut is damaged, your immune system is gone. The headquarters of your gut is in the immune system. That's why in America now, if you have a very bad infection, with superbugs and nothing helps, do you know the treatment? Give someone else's shit through a Ryle's tube. And when once you replace the gut with the normal flora, the infection disappears in 4 hours. This is called fecal transplant. So America does it, so we accept it. Now we've gone one step further. In America, you get poop capsules. Small capsules, $5. So it boosts your immune system. That is the strength of Ayurveda. What does Ayurveda say? Panchakarma. In Panchakarma, you're only boosting the immune system. I have a Western medical doctor, a professor of radiology in a medical college in Maharashtra, who had a massive heart attack. And they did everything for him. bypass surgery, this, that, but he was not able to get up from bed. He said, I am going to use the Ayurvedic method. He caught hold of cow's colostrum, which is a very good immune booster. And he has produced a tablet called Immugen. And he has now got back. He doesn't take any medicine. And he is absolutely fine. He has left the medical college. And he is doing this business of selling immune boosters. So happy. His ejection fraction has come back to normal. He is 24 hours, he is working. And he has forgotten his heart. He is heartless now. That is the power. But then you should know when to mix, when to combine. If you go on saying that across the board, I'll say all systems must come together, nothing will happen. Because they hate each other like, you know, mouse and the mongoose and the snakes. So because, what is the hatred, do you know? I'll take you to history, because history, you learn from history. If you do not, you relive history. 50 years before the American Medical Association started, doctors in America thought their methods of treatment were so bad that they wanted to homeopathic association. So the first homeopathic association in America started 50 years before medical association started by American MD doctors. And who was Heinemann? He was an MD doctor in Germany. He couldn't save his own son when the needle went into him and he gets septicemia and died. This man thought, what's the use of all my MD degree? I have not been able to save my son. Then of course he copied from a Canadian doctor who had written a book on this. Similibus. And it was not originally his. And always in history, the man who publishes a thing in the world gets the credit. You know, Nobel Prize are also like that. The man really who invented doesn't get the credit. So that Canadian man didn't get any credit. Anyway, homeopathy exists. Now homeopathy also has got certain advantages. It has got a lot of problems. Modern medicine has certain advantages, let me tell you. Supposing I fall down under the car in Delhi roads, I can't say I'll do yoga and sit and do om and then get back. No, somebody has to set my bones, somebody has to do something. But then what we don't realize is, youngsters who go without a helmet in the road, I tell them, nobody can help you if your head is broken. Doctors cannot do anything for brain injury. We just hoping against hope that something will happen. If the patient recovers, we take the credit. If the patient dies, we give the credit to God. He always kills and we save. So have a helmet, because nobody can save. Now these kind of things modern medicine can do. We can't throw modern medicine out of the window. Because the water in modern medicine is bad, I don't want to throw the baby out. I still want to keep the baby. But modern medicine also requires a lot of refinement. I'll give you an example. In Vietnam War, America had a 5-star hospital 10 minutes from the war theater. So a grievously injured soldier is lifted in a C-130, which in itself is an ICU. The C-130 which lifts these people is an ICU. So it starts blood transfusion, etc. immediately. So he's taken to the ICU, 5-star treatment. Poor British had a war in Falklands. No enemies, no friends in South America. And then the whole patient had to be shifted 16 hours to London. And some of the patients there were left on the snow, grievously injured patients, for as long as 24 to 48 hours. Because the war occurred October, November, December. Now, audits now shows that per capita death of comparable grievously injured soldiers was slightly more in Vietnam than in Falklands. People are working now. Scientific brains are working as to why it happened. One of the reasons is, you immediately interfere. Nature has provided a beautiful system inside in injury. You and I were in forest. We were hunter-gatherers. Tigers comes. And tiger eats. Tiger can't eat whole of you. It doesn't have the appetite. It'll eat maybe your hand. Did I say anything wrong? Can you see an electron? Huh? You can? Have you seen, sir? That's a different thing. That's a different thing. My question. No, wait. Answer my question. Have you seen an electron?
This is not a relevant question.
Okay. The question itself is irrelevant. But nobody can see an electron. How do I see you, sir? Physics wise, how do I see you?
You are seeing me through electrons.
Okay, alright. A few photons leave your body and strike my retina and I see you. If one photon leaves an electron, the electron is not an electron. So you can never see. Good, you are a physicist. I like it.
I would like to argue.
Thank you. Leave it at that. Anyway, my interpretation is very simple. You can't see an electron, you can't see God. But anyway, let's not go into God. Nature gave us an autonomic nervous system. Most of our health problems are because of the autonomic nervous system today. In the forest, you saw the tiger. And when you saw the tiger, you are frightened. You want to run away. To run away, you require glucose. So there is no glucoside in the forest. So nature said, okay, I will give you gunny bags of sugar in the liver called glycogen, from where you get your glucose. And for that, its sympathetic system produces adrenaline. Adrenaline goes to the liver, sugar is released. It's called neoglucogenesis. A biochemistry professor will tell you. Neo means new, gluco means glucose, genesis is birth. Now the sugar goes up, you can run. Your blood pressure has to go up, so adrenaline increases the blood pressure, vasoconstriction. Your heart rate has to grow up, chronotropicity, heart rate grows up, and you run. When you run from the tiger, if you survive the tiger, your whole thing comes down. You're up. The sugar which has gone up has come down. The sugar, blood pressure comes down. Today we have transformed ourselves into society. Here there are no tigers, but there are human tigers here. Your husband may be a tiger, your wife may be a tiger, your boss may be a tiger, your assistant may be a tiger, your peon may be a tiger, your driver may be a tiger. When you look at these people, your blood pressure goes up, your sugar goes up, but you can't run away from them. You got to stay there. And when you stay there, they remain high, and over a period of years, you become a hypertensive, you become a diabetic, you become, you know, all these things. All these things can be managed by change of mode of living. 1733, there was a young professor of medicine in Vienna. His name was Charles Schasmitz. This boy wrote the first textbook of medicine where he said, I have seen patients with vehement agitation of the mind and chronic constriction of the vascular bed. And when they die, I look at the heart, it's like a bull's heart with so much of thickness. Now, very interesting. And what was the treatment he suggested in 1733 textbook? Change of mode of living. Tranquility of mind. And the third, drugs, if ever, rarely, full stop. If you do that same thing today, most of our hypertensive, diabetic patients will completely become normal. You just look at the science of giving a chemical drug for lowering your sugar, lowering your blood pressure. What does this do? Nothing. Do you know what helps? The placebo effect. The faith in the medicine, faith in the doctor that I have taken the medicine will lower your sugar. You may wonder, what is he talking about? You know, somebody will say, I'm a doctor, so I can argue till the cows come home that you are wrong. There's a study done in four universities, Oxford, Cambridge, Munich, and Hamburg, where they gave morphia drip. Morphia is the most powerful painkiller. Morphia drip for patients with severe pain. But while giving, they explained, this is a study we are doing. This is not morphia. This is a drug which will improve your health, but not your pain. We are just seeing what is the effect of that new drug. Nobody's pain went. What was running in the drip? Morphia. So they took a crossover study. The same patient was taken over the other side, and they were running what is called saline. You know, saline is salt water. And they told the patient, this is the recent salt of morphia. Very powerful. Your pain will go. Pain went. So they were nonplussed. So what did they do next? They said, we'll do fMRI and see what the brain does. So they did an fMRI and repeated the test. When the patient believed the doctor that it's not morphia, his brain slept. When the patient believed the doctor that it is morphia and what was going was saline, his forebrain produced so much of powerful opioids, much more powerful than opium, and the pain disappeared. This is called the placebo effect. You want to know more about it? Write down. The placebo effect. That's the article's name. The first author's name is Bingel, Professor Bingel. He is a professor of medicine in Oxford. And the journal is a very prestigious journal called Journal Science Translational Medicine, STM it is called. Science Translational Medicine. Year is 2011. Semicolon. Now what is important in this study is, it's a mind that tells you that look, you are okay because your doctor has given you this medicine. So it doesn't mean whether it's Ayurveda, Umapathy, Ayurveda, anything. As long as the doctor's faith, doctor commands the faith of the patient, Many of us demand the faith of the patient, which is not coming. He must command. The moment he sees his doctor, you are God, do what you like, I'll be all right. And he will be all right. So it's the placebo effect, ultimately. Enama? Kedichada? You may say, okay, this may be for medicine, but surgery? Surgery certainly, I know, we are doing very well. Surgery certainly is good. One of my former chiefs in Harvard did a study. He is about 94 now. He even now conducts studies. He's alive and healthy. He's the man who invented that shock you give to patients in the defibrillator. It's called Lowndes defibrillator. His name is Bernard Lowndes. He's a Nobel laureate. What he did was, over the last 5 years, some 600 patients were sent for bypass surgery. Those days we were doing it with a laser tip. And bypass surgery, what's called transmyocardial revascularization. So he said, none of these people require it. So one by one as they came, first one went to theater A, second one went to theater B. And in theater A, the protocol was anesthetize, operate, send. Theater B was anesthetize, keep him lying down there for 1 hour, wake him up, and then tell him you had a wonderful operation and send him home. Do you want to know the study's results? These people who went to theater B, they're all fine even now. Thallium study showed their myocardium is completely revascularized. And those who went to theater A, the first 30 days after myocardial infarction, I mean revascularization, a lot of people die. It's called the 30 days death rate. Here there are two people who died in B, 8 people died in A. And now, other than the two people who died, rest of them are all fine. And on the other side, half of them had open bypass surgery after that because they had intractable pain. One half of the other half, they are in heaven with their maker. The other half of the other half is having ADR, adverse drug reactions. Yes, sir. Just place there. So even surgery to a great extent is a placebo effect. I have had surgery. That's it. They are fine after that. Is that right? You want to know that? First write down the author's name. Roger Laham. He is Bernard Lowndes' first assistant. Roger Laham et al. Et al. Is and others. Okay. The study is called Laser Revascularization of Coronary Artery Disease. Laser Revascularization of Coronary Artery Disease. Okay. Journal is called Journal of the American College of Cardiology. Journal of the American College of Cardiology. JACC it is called. Year is 2005. Volume is 42. And page is 1822. Now, very interesting, this study you must study and see how the mind works on the body. And where is the mind?
In the heart.
In the heart. Where is the mind? Never mind. The mind is not in the brain. All that you should know is mind is not in the brain and mind is everywhere and mind is consciousness. So consciousness is mind and we have two kinds of things. The same thing in Sanatana Dharma. Atman and Paramatman. Your mind is your individual consciousness and the universal consciousness is what we call as God, but it's energy. God is energy. God is love. Universal consciousness is Paramatman. So the same thing happens in science also, if you understand. And the consciousness works, and consciousness is the thing that runs the whole world. So if you understand that, all of us are relatives, very close relatives. And we should love one another, not because it is good for others, it is good for us. Because our own cells, if you look at them with the photon, biophoton camera, they love one another, they speak to each other, they communicate with one another, and they're dancing in sync. You are healthy. If one part of the cells are not happy, you are having a disease. So disease is not organ-based. Heart disease, lung disease, brain disease, head disease, leg disease, no. It is in the body. Remember that. And a professor of medicine in Yale, she's a very intelligent girl. Her name is Mary Tinetti. She has written a beautiful article in the Archives of Internal Medicine called The End of the Disease Era. The End of the Disease Era. It's not archives, it's American Journal of Medicine. Write down that, you read that. Mary Tinetti, M-A-R-Y-T-I-N-N-E-T-T-I, Mary Tinetti. And her assistant's name is Steed. Steed is also an author. STEAD.
The journal is American Journal of Medicine, AMJ. And here is 2004. Volume is 116. And page is 179. Now, very interestingly, Mary says, the old idea of disease, diagnosis, etc. has to be given up, because if we apply that to the modern system of medicine treatment, you are either over-treating, under-treating, or mistreating. So most of the time, we harm patients by our conventional treatment methods. So to cut it, put it in a nutshell, ladies and gentlemen, what we need is a future new system, which is an integration of the good in the all the systems. The systems should not have hatred, like, you know, one caste hating another caste, one upper caste, Brahmin caste, and one lower caste, and things like that. So modern medicine is not upper caste. All are same caste, human caste. And we must have a common platform where every patient can access the resource from various systems as and when he wants, with some guidance from people like Ahluwalia or somebody, you know, who can put the systems together. Even Tony is trying to do a big thing on, he's got an organization where he's trying to put things together. This I have written about years ago as what's called meta-medicine. You know, physics was written by Aristotle first, and then he wrote psychology. That's why psychology is called metaphysics. After, meta is after. So meta-medicine is medicine after the so-called modern medicine, which is a conglomeration of all systems without caste system. So every system has its very important things. Like, for example, homeopathy, let me tell you. Somebody did a wonderful study in Glasgow University on two drugs in homeopathy, Arum triphylatum and Sambucus nigri. And they showed there's a such a powerful effect on viral infections, especially the upper respiratory infections, which you think may be a minor thing. In Europe in winter, on a given day, 50 million people do not go to work because of feverish cold. There's a subtle difference between common cold and feverish cold. Common cold is caused by rhinoviruses. Feverish cold is caused by adenoviruses. But today we use the virus to frighten people and mask our sins. Zika is a new example. Everybody is frightened. I get about 20 emails every day from pregnant women. I am pregnant. They say Zika is coming to India. Will my child have a small head? I said, your child will have a big head. Don't worry. Zika has not done anything to anybody so far. Zika has been in existence from 1947. And to the best of my knowledge, it has not killed anybody. But Brazil, what happened is, Brazil, the I don't want to tell the name of the company, the spraying of chemicals on the food and food plant growth is so much that 473 children suddenly had microcephaly when they were born. Each one of them had about 200 chemicals in their umbilical blood. Now the company doesn't want this to be published. So they caught hold of the government and said, now the Zika virus is there. Why don't you connect that to the Zika virus? When they did the study, out of the 473, unfortunately only two kids had some antibodies against Zika, because Zika is a common thing. You and I can have Zika virus antibodies. Suddenly the government said, Zika virus is the cause. So the WHO got into the act and everybody said, Zika, 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 Zika. And I tell you now, pregnant women in the West are terribly worried, because the vaccine company has come up with a Zika vaccine. This is how the world runs. So let us love one another. If you love one another, you don't want to encourage cancer, you don't want to encourage Zika, you want to encourage people to be healthy. And you and I, we have wasted all our time to come here. I am sure your idea is to help humanity. Am I right? And we should try to find out the truth. How do you find out the truth? Go deep into it. Otherwise you will never know. You will never know. I am not saying Ayurveda has no problem. Ayurveda has a lot of problems. Do you know why? The Ayurvedic doctors are a menace to society. They don't know what Ayurveda is. Most of them who studied with BHAM, they don't know what Ayurveda is. And they think Ayurveda can treat everything. And then they give you steroid tablets, etc. That's not Ayurveda. Ayurvedic pharmacies are also not honest. Ayurvedic basmas, today's basmas you sent to American laboratory, you can have all kinds of chemicals, including mercury and things like that. Do you know why? The real Shastra of Dravyas Sutra is, you prepare this Ayurvedic basmas by sealing it in a mud pack and keeping it under the earth, dig it down and put it there for 12 years. In 12 years,
there's what's called anaerobic cooking, and every metal becomes nano and pico particles, and nobody can detect a metal, and doesn't damage the, today's basmas damage the kidney. So nobody's honest. Homeopaths. I met a homeopath came to me and said, sir, I can treat hypertension with my drugs in no time. I said, fine, you have a record, get it to me, I'll publish it. He said, I'll come. He never came. And he doesn't have a record. See, this is where the problem is. A lot of homeopaths say, I can cure cancer. He doesn't know what cancer is. He can cure cancer. When a Nobel laureate biologist doesn't know what cancer is, Albert Zengayorgi is a Nobel laureate biologist who has written this book called Introduction to Submolecular Biology, where he says, I don't know what cancer is. Because a cancer cell works exactly like a normal cell. And I cannot make a distinction between a cancer cell and a normal cell. And you can't kill a cancer cell without killing an equal number of normal cells or more. Who is writing this? Nobel laureate. And a 2 Nobel Prize winner, Linus Pauling, says, the whole cancer industry is fraud. Cancer research is fraud. Cancer charities are fraud, he says. Not once, several times. So, there is this filth everywhere. Whether it's Ayurveda, Yajurveda, or Umapathy, making money, if you think is your aim, you are a fraud. But helping society is your aim, you have a lot of opportunities. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to express my thoughts, which may be foolish. A lot of it may be questioned. But I would like you to question it by finding the truth. And that will be a great thing. And I've given you some sources to read. Please read them. And all of you must read this book, beautiful book, written by a professor of history in London. The book is Bad Medicine. What is the book's name? Bad Medicine. Subheading is Doctors Harming Patients since Hippocrates. Doctors Harming Patients since Hippocrates. And who has written that? David Wooton. D-A-V-I-D, W-O-O-T-T-O-N. Wooton is a professor and head of the Department of History in the Liverpool University. He's a brilliant chap. He's written a lot of books, but this book is one of his best books. So please read that book. I think 2006 or 2007. Oh, you put Wooton and Bad Medicine, it'll jump out in Amazon and come out and give you the book. O-N. Wooton. O-N. O-N. O for orange. A for apple. Okay. Now, if you have any quick questions, you can ask with a keynote or no note, doesn't matter. If I know the answer, I'll give it to you. If I don't know, I'll try to let you know later.
Very simple question. What do we do now?
Ah, that's a good question. That's a fascinating question. If you are not a type 1 diabetic, if you are not a childhood diabetic, I think you don't need insulin. But today's company's law is, everybody should take insulin so that you know you are controlled very well. And they'll come with the insulin pen. Have you bought one? See. Because each pen prescribed gets registered in the computer of the pharmacy. And then the fellow will come and say, madam, you have written the number of pens. You are our best bet. Next, you know, visit, you will have a cruise from Alaska with your wife and your children and all. And then when you come back, we'll give you a Maruti car and things like that. So won't I be very interested in doing that? And they get their speakers. They'll give you such a nice lecture with beautiful slides all made in the company that you think if you don't give insulin, patients are going to die. No, what do you do? I didn't treat you. I didn't give you anything. I only said this is how it happens. You may wonder as to why suddenly there is a resurgence of insulin's interest. Because the companies are interested in insulin. And do you know they are interested in keeping you a diabetic? That is why they ask you at a million to eat chapati. Are you making chapati at home? Ama. See, what is happening is the wheat has gluten in it. And gluten directly damages the beta cells in the pancreas. And gluten keeps you a diabetic permanently, so that you become a permanent patient. The best treatment is the millets. Millets have a special vitamin called vitamin B17, which is called laetril. And laetril, from cancer to common cold, it boosts your immune system. And there is a doctor in Mysore. He's a very highly qualified agricultural doctor. He left a big company in America, big salary. He has come and he's growing these millets in a 5-acre plot. It doesn't require, millets are very interesting. They don't require much water. Ragi, navane, bajra, seve, jawar, all that. And he is treating patients with diabetes and hypertension with only this. He has got a clinic, free. You go there, he'll give you all the nice things made out of Mysore.
What is the name, sir?
Kadar, Dr. Kadar. K-H-A-D-E-R. Kadar, 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 Kadar. K-H-A-D-E-R. Very nice man. So, you know, there are methods. I have not treated you. I have given you suggestions.
Yeah, yeah. I use regression technique, that is recall technique, and it is based on cell has consciousness. And I work for all medical illness, that is. And I have had quite a good success.
It's a very good method. Continue doing it. But keep a record of what you do. And if anybody has side effect, record that also.
No,
no, no. No, that's easy to say that, if at all. Because for the future, you must be honest. Record keeping must be authentic.
Okay, can you talk a little bit about the whole field of energetics and particularly occult?
Okay, that's a good question. Well, I didn't specifically talk about that because our physicist is there. Now, we have this known energies, electromagnetic energies. We have electromagnetic energy. I have been playing with it for quite some time now. It originally came from NASA. In NASA, they were using electromagnetic energy, their sun's energy, for rejuvenating the space people who go there. When they come back, they used to be paralyzed in the olden days. You would have seen in the early part, they were taken on a stretcher to the hospital. Today, they jump out and walk. That's all because the electromagnetic energy being used. So we have been using it for treating diseases like any ischemia, heart attack, brain attack, or any inflammation, like, you know, arthritis and things like that, or broken bones. And we have wonderful results. We have got all the records, and I have got a small little device now. I have invented that. With the, using the NASA's game plan, we have made a small little device, which is called the EM pulse. And this is just sun's energy, but what we have done is we have pulsed it so that it doesn't continuously go and heat the system. So it's remarkable. Like, for example, you have say, facial paralysis, what's called Bell's palsy. In 2 hours, I can make your face come back to normal. If you have a stroke, you can get it within 48 hours. Heart attack, 24 to 48 hours. It can do all that. But we are trying to expand it and see what it does, and with some success, like Parkinsonism, where the degeneration occurs. In degeneration, it's not very effective. In damage, acute damage, like cell damage, but if your cells are all dead, it can't do nothing. That's one thing. Now about occult energy, our group has done one study, which is yet to be published. And this is a very interesting study. If you want to know, I'll tell you. This man is a professor of radio therapy in the University of Irvine in California. His name is Joey Jones, J-O-I-E-J-O-N-E-S. Joey got some grant from NIH to do a study on pranic healing and cancer. Joey is a cancer specialist. He's the head of the Department of Cancerology in the same university. Joey had cancer himself, and he didn't take conventional treatment. He got treated by the pranic healers, and he's fine. So Joey started the study where we have got this, you know, cell line called HeLa cells. You can grow cancer cells in the laboratory and irradiate them in gamma rays. They become cancer in a week or two. So he did that. Then covered that with a Faraday box. Our professor of physics will tell you that known energy can enter a Faraday box. To be certain, he also put a lead cover and then called the pranic healers to pray for them. Okay? So the pranic healers sat in his laboratory and prayed. It has got some other very interesting anecdotes, which I won't mention now for want of time. And then he found 88% of the cells becoming normal in 2 weeks' time. This is the first study of human cell line cancer being treated by occult energy called pranic healing. It must be done by genuine pranic healers. Amerindian pranic healers are very powerful people. Now this man was not satisfied. Though we were very happy and we were telling him, you are fine. He said, no, it must be 100%. I don't believe in this statistical 88% and all. So he said, why 12% have not? And he is a great proponent of Indian philosophy, Sanatana Dharma. He said, there must be some reason, some karma on these cells. They have not. So do you know what he did? There were three observers from NIH because they had given $100,000. So they had come to see whether he is doing eating the money or doing something. He told the observers, each one of you write a check for $100, your own money, tax-paid money, genuine money, not black money, white money, and give it for a charity and pray, let the good karma of my charity go to the cells. Would you believe second time 100% of the cells became normal? So you clapped, but the poor man is in jail. Because his colleagues filed a case against him, saying that he has done something which is not scientific, quote-unquote. It's hocus-pocus, and he is diverting science attention. He is wasting the government's money, and the poor man is in trouble. His wife calls me and says, no, nobody to fight his case. See? And she says, I've got all the documents, all the ledgers, please publish. Now I said, if he comes out of the jail, he has to write it, because if he writes it himself, it's very good. This is the world. In the world, the only casualty is truth. Though we say satyameva jayate, but what we are doing is anratmeva jayate. Na satyam. Yes, Sardarji. I know that crystals. Yeah, that I have seen. I have even communicated with him. But they are all there. Such stress is there. But this is a human healing I'm talking about.
So why did you
start operating? Time gap.
We have to. I'm so sorry.
America. Because he was a long-winded speaker. He said, Tom, now you have become the president. Stand up, speak up, and shut up. Thank you.